All right, guys, on this Lamb Beat episode, we're going to talk about the differences between doing TSI and creating a bedding thicket. Both involve running a chainsaw and cutting trees, but there are some subtle and distinct differences about what we want the end result to be. We're going to show you that here on Lamb Beat. All right, guys, this is a TSI unit that Adam was cutting on yesterday. We've returned to the site to talk about the differences in cutting techniques and what that end desired result is. Back behind me, you can see some really large white oaks. The goal here was to reduce the hickory composition in and around these large white oaks to hopefully increase the herbaceous layer, but also to increase mass production out of these white oaks. So we're not cutting this area nearly as hard as we would a bedding thicket. We need some sunlight in, but we're not going for that 80 to 100% sunlight. We're gonna try and do 30 to 50% maybe in this area. And that difference in amount of sunlight coming in is gonna create a different plant response in this unit in the understory, which is great. But that difference in sunlight is gonna have a different plant response. And so wildlife, namely deer, are gonna relate differently to that. On top of that, the way that the majority of these trees were cut in a TSI situation is not going to be as attractive for cover from a bedding standpoint as the other technique. So as we're here, you can see a lot of these trees were flush cut. They were flush cut, put all the way down on the ground, flat against the ground. Many of these were smaller trees, mid-story trees, did not have big, great canopies. So in that TSI situation, when you flush cut them, they lay pretty much flat against the ground. Not as conducive to that height and structure component that we're gonna see in a second. But as we look across here, we have a good number of trees that were thin. We can count and see, you know, 15 or 20 trees. But as we're looking across here, we might have 2 foot tall worth of trunk and canopy across the ground. As we move to the other area, we're gonna see a stark difference. Again, both were running a chainsaw, both were completing timber work, but the end result of structure and then what's to come in the vegetation types on this site are gonna offer two different situations that deer are going to relate to. One, more or less food and some comfort cover as this gets more herbaceous, but another as dense cover, that is escape cover and bedding location where we're gonna see a lot of daytime usage. This might be an area where you would routinely see deer get up from a bed, move through here during daylight hours, feed a little bit before they move on to another, maybe destination type food plot. But this is a kind of comfort cover. There's a little bit of structure in the ground, but not nearly to the degree of what we're about to go see. All right, guys, we slid just down the ridge into a more aggressive unit, right? You see a lot more sun back behind me. We opened up the canopy greatly in this small unit. We dropped a lot of trees. We use a combination of flush cuts and hinge cuts, as you can see. And as a result of that, you see a much different structure value immediately here in this unit. Right now, we've got some areas about 4 foot tall worth of stump and branches and canopy laid across the ground. That is immediate cover for deer. They can bed up and against it. But we need to think about multiple years down the road as well. So we've used a combination of flush cutting for that, a combination of hinge cutting and flush cutting for that immediate cover, but then down the road, we need that added sunlight. If we had just hinge cut everything in here, we would have just shortened the canopy. As it would have greened up next year, we would not have gotten that added sunlight component. So this combination of hinge cutting and flush cutting for many years down the road has a higher value in return from a cover standpoint and from a forage standpoint offered in this unit. We've maximized the amount of sunlight to come in here by using flush cutting and hinge cutting. And over here, these hickories were flush cut, right? We wanna be mindful. This was a decent sized tree, so it had a larger canopy. We wanted to be mindful of that and put it flat to the ground and then maybe add some of the smaller, maybe 6 to 8 inch diameter trees in a hinge cut that weren't gonna take up as much room and allow for deer to be able to navigate not only in this unit, but around the unit more freely. We want this to be super usable, so we have to be mindful of how much debris we're putting on the ground and where that debris is placed on the ground. So felling these trees flat makes for more usable space. And then if we go to some of these smaller trees back over here, like this 4 inch tree and this 6 inch hickory, Those were much more easier, one, to navigate and put exactly where you want to, but they don't have nearly the debris and clutter higher off the ground. So just understanding the value of this tree should have been flush cut as these were hinge cut creates this perfect dynamic for success in bedding now and in the years to come, as we're gonna have sprouts to come off of this hinge, but then also this flush cut. But you'll also see flush cuts at different heights. And this was mainly because of there was three stumps coming off together, but flush cutting, we're trying to go 10 inches, maybe 12 inches off the ground. So in years to come, when we get that regeneration out of a hinge cut, it's already advanced, but flush cut, we've got years worth of browsing opportunity instead of maybe one or two growing seasons out of a hinge cut that's about 3 foot off the ground. That food would be way out of reach for a deer. So having this combination of structure works perfectly, encourages deer to bed in here, feel comfortable in here from the moment you cut it to the next time fire rolls through here, which is probably on this site gonna be about every 4 to 5 years.